follow me is wise. Like a person who builds a house on a solid rock. Say solid rock.
Solid rock.
Though the rain comes.
Yes.
Tell your neighbor, it's going to come. It's going to come. Tell them it's going to come. Comes in torrents. And the flood waters rise. And the winds beat against that house. It won't collapse. Because it is built on a rock. Somebody say, my house built on a rock. Receive the word, Lord God, so we can become doers and not just hearers, Lord. We get excited because we know, Lord, that you have placed the man of God in this place to feed us with knowledge and understanding, Lord God. And as we receive the word, Lord God, we will go forth and make disciples, Lord God, of your people. We will do your word, Lord God. We will focus on the things that you have created us to do, Lord God. So we thank you for this opportunity, Lord God. We thank you that even though we know flood may rise, Lord God, rain may fall, Lord God, but you are our rock, Lord, and from the back, we stand on a firm, strong foundation, Lord God. See, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Every lie tongue that rises against us in judgment we condemn. Greater is he that is within us than he that is in the world. Hallelujah! And Lord, when we can't see our way, we will look to the hills. Because we know all our hope comes from you. This is your servant's prayer. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Provided for me, who loved me. And what more could we say about our Heavenly Father, who provides for us, who takes care of us, who loves us? So to my Heavenly Father, we want to sing this song. Lord, you are good. You've been so good. You've been better than me. I can't thank you enough. I can't praise you enough. You've been so good. I need no prayer. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Lord, you are good. You've been so good.
If you haven't had a chance to Thank you. praise God for you. At this time, we'll have our announcements for the week by Sister Tana Moss.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The obedience requirements, new members orientation, second and fourth Sundays, 9:30 a.m., Tuesdays, 3 p.m., and 6:30 p.m. Prayer service and Bible study, Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m., Sunday fellowship, Sunday school at 9:30 a.m.,
Amen.
Worship service at 11 p.m.,
Amen.
Church business meeting.
Yes.
All members are welcome to attend our annual mid-year business meeting. It will be held Tuesday, June 18th at 7:05 p.m. in the sanctuary.
Amen.
Lily Baptist Church anniversary. Sunday, June 23rd at 4 p.m., Pastor McKenzie will be preaching the word at Lily Baptist Church in Jackson, Michigan for their church anniversary. Amen. Vacation Bible School. Macedonia VBS will be held June 24th through the 27th. Dinner will be served at 5 p.m. The theme for 2019 is VIP, Victory, Identity, and Praise.
Yes.
The guest teachers for the adult class are Reverend Jason Robinson from Reach Church, teaching about victory, and Reverend Jerry Wilkerson from Friendship Baptist Church, teaching about identity. If you have not registered, please do so with our VBS director, Sister Stephanie Maston.
Amen.
Fifth Sunday Fellowship. Sunday, June 30th at 6 p.m., Fifth Sunday Fellowship will take place at Grace Temple Church of God. The preacher bringing the word will be Pastor Bobby McKenzie.
Amen. Yeah.
Remember when Pastor preached, music rehearsals. Triumphant Adult Praise Dance, Sundays after the worship service. Voice of Macedonia and Tequila Adult Praise, Saturday before first and third Sunday at 11. Mime Times, Tuesdays at 5:30 p.m. Chosen Generation and Tequila Youth Praise, Saturday before second and fourth Sundays at 11 a.m. Triumphant Youth Praise Team, Saturdays at 12:30 p.m.
Amen.
There will be a meeting immediately after service for all ministerial leaders. Please meet in the L for planning pastor's fifth anniversary.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Ms. Mawson. Our announcements. Just a reminder. It's going to be a busy end to the month.
Yes.
Yeah, busy, busy, busy. So, but we're still hoping and praying that you guys will get the rest you need and all the sleep that you've been missing out on and all that stuff, that we'll be able to rest our bodies and get the proper rest that we need, because we got a lot of work to do to finish up this month. Next Sunday, as it was announced, we will be headed over, after we have done our worship experience here, we'll be headed over to Lily Baptist for their church anniversary.
Amen.
So we're looking for all Macedonia members and friends to come go with us so that we can actually preach the word. I see Brother Arnold with his hand up. Oh, look at that.
Somebody going to have to
address
posted.
Yes, somebody gonna have an address posted, and somebody gonna have a driver's list, a bus list. Address is on the list. It's already posted. Okay, yeah. So you should be able to find that information on the board in the vestibule. And so we're definitely looking for everybody to come go with us. And then the very next day, Lord Jesus, the next day is DBS. Monday the 24th through Thursday the 27th, we will be celebrating our annual VBS with the theme VIP. The young people will be having an amazing time, and make sure tell everybody that you know, young and senior, that we are here for VBS and everybody is welcome. To our adults, just to make sure you have a high quality worship and learning experience. We're bringing in some guests to help do some teaching. So on Monday, the 24th, Pastor Jason Robinson will be here from Reach Church to teach us about victory. And on Tuesday, Pastor Jerry Wilkerson will be here to teach us about our identity in Christ. And if the Lord say the same, and as we sit down softly, the creek don't rise. On Wednesday, yours truly will be teaching on praise. Can I set it up for you? If you had victory on Monday, and then you're reminded on who you are on Tuesday, it shouldn't be hard for you to praise you on Wednesday, right? So you don't want to miss these sessions. It will bless your very soul. And so we thank God for you in advance for
I tried to write it fast. I just wanted the church family to know that we have two travelers in our midst on Tuesday next week. Mrs. Malia Frost and Zariah Kemp will be traveling with the sister city to France on Tuesday. We'll be flying out of Detroit, and I, as a mother, and Mrs. Wanda Kemp, we're both praying for our children, but we need prayer for our children as they travel. They'll be gone for a full week, staying with host families over there. What's the city? Noisy, France. And so just pray for them and hope they're safe travels. And they're going to come back and share what they learned. But we are so proud of them for being chosen to represent Albion. And there's actually an Albion, France, over there. So they're going to a market that says Albion. So it's our sister city thing and our church. So thank you.
Amen. Grace, as you cross the water, come back home safe and sound. And so praise God for that. And so next Sunday, we will be headed to Lily Baptist, and then we have BBS. And then that following Sunday, the fifth Sunday, the first thing that's going to happen on the fifth Sunday, if the Lord say the same, that we're going to have General Assembly. We're going to have General Assembly for Sunday school. And if you happen to have been here this past Wednesday, Wednesday night prayer service, and you know what we were talking about. See, some of you don't know that when we say something about tea now, you don't know what we're talking about. The rest of us don't know about some tea. But we want to bring, make sure everyone is here, all our adults, all of our young people. You don't want to miss Sunday school the next couple of weeks, especially on the fifth Sunday. We're going to have General Assembly. And so let me give a message, if you will, those of you who are streaming live, who possibly weren't planning to be at Sunday school the next couple of weeks. I would hope that if you can, you'll change your plans. Because on the fifth Sunday, we're not going to teach out of the book.
Amen.
So your book won't help you.
Amen.
So you're going to want to be here.
Amen.
Lord have mercy.
Amen.
So go ahead and plan it. So don't plan 2 weeks out that you're going to not be here. Go and plan to be here.
Amen.
Lord have mercy.
Amen.
We also are soliciting your prayers. We're soliciting your prayers. All those individuals on the special prayer request list, some of them are back on their feet. We see Sister Letitia McGee is here. We know what she has been through, and so we're continuing to pray for her. But we have not had the privilege to lay our eyes on Sister Elizabeth Carter and Sister Johnny Craig and some others. And it's not that they don't want to be here. They can't be here. And so we are soliciting your prayers for them and everyone on our sick and shut in and our special prayer request list. Please pray their strength in the Lord, that God will strengthen them and heal them. Because if you can't go see them and you can't do nothing else, I believe that as a church we can pray.
Amen.
So we thank God for all of you, and happy Father's Day to all of our fathers. And as we get ready to receive our offering, those of you that are somewhat technology savvy, if you know some men or some fathers who actually can get here in the next 10 minutes, we want them to come. And it's not too late. If they happen to awaken this morning a little late and they thought, well, you know, it's too late to go to church. No, it's not. Call them, text them, Instagram, whatever. Let them come on. If they, they need to get out of their PJs, but they ain't got to put on a suit. But if they can get here, we want to have them here, because God has sent a word for fathers today. And we want the fathers to receive this word. Amen? Let's get ready to give. One more thing, I'm sorry. Thank you to everyone that came out to celebrate Jeffrey's open house yesterday. Thanks to Joe Hardy from Jackson and all over the place to come and be with us in Kalamazoo.
Amen.
And we say thank you. And once again, congratulations to all our graduates and their various students and degrees. And your open houses, we hope they're amazing also.
Amen.
Let's get ready to you. If you don't mind, open your envelopes up. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, God, for allowing us the privilege to give back to you.
Yes.
Thank you, God, that you thought it not robbery to give us something that we can then obey you and give back to you, so that we get credit for being obedient, so that you can bless us some more. We love you today, and we believe, God, that every heart, every hand that is in the air, that, Lord, you are already supplying their very need according to your riches and glory. And now, God, we're not only asking for you to supply their need, we're asking that you go a ceiling abundantly above whatever they can ask, think, or imagine. We love you today. In Jesus' name, amen. We start to give it off, Father, by our preachers, our deacons, our trustees, and then you, my sisters, and my brothers. At this time, would you please stand and face the wall, and us as we're down here. Ephesians chapter 6. Just one verse, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4. As you are making your way to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4, I want to thank Minister Shonette Spicer for preaching that word last week. Reminding us that God is greater than our struggle. Amen. Amen. I've got report after report that she tore it up. And still feasting on that word. Amen. 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 Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4. And it reads from the King James Version of the Bible. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Just for a few minutes, I want to preach from the sermon title, It's a Privilege to Be a Father. It's a privilege to be a father. I don't know if we're doing teen church today. I have no idea. So we're going to stay together today. Trust me, young people, we'll get you another time. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 6, based on that scripture, it's a privilege to be a father. Tell your neighbor, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Old neighbor.
Old neighbor.
Preacher's going to preach.
Preacher's going to preach.
And it's a privilege.
It's a privilege.
To be a father.
To be a father.
As we continue the preaching topics of building relationships and building strong foundations, and as we celebrate Father's Day today, I want to let you know that there is no greater earthly foundation for the family, for the church, and for the community than a father. Let me say that one more time. There is no greater earthly foundation for a family, for the church, and for the community than a father.
Amen.
It's a privilege, fathers, to have someone to acknowledge you and to call you dad.
Yes.
It's a privilege to have someone call you father, or pop, or poppy, or pawpaw, or pop-pop, or paw, or granddad, or granddaddy, or whatever they call you, big daddy, whatever they call you. It's a privilege to have someone to acknowledge you and to call you those special names, especially early on, especially when the kids are younger. When you have really young kids, babies, so to speak, they don't really care if you're running for president or if you're actually going to prison. They love you unconditionally. And it's a privilege to have a child to just love you, even though they don't understand you, even they don't know your shortcomings, they just love you. It's a privilege to be a father. It's a privilege to pass on your name to another generation. It's a privilege to pass on your wealth to another generation. It's a privilege to pass on your wisdom and your life experiences, your values, your guidance, your caution, and hopefully your testimony with the Lord. It's a privilege to be able to pass that on to the next generation. Listen, the Bible tells us something in a couple of scriptures, Proverbs chapter 1, verse 8. It says, my son, hear the instructions of thy father, and forsake not the law of thy mother. Proverbs 1 and 10 says, my son, if sinners entice you, consent thou not. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 1. My son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 11. My son, y'all get the theme here? My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. It's a privilege. Say it's a privilege. It's a privilege to help shape the life of a child, so that they can avoid the mistakes that you made and they can benefit from the things and the ways that you wish you had done. There's this popular thing now, it's been out for a little while, Mr. Spicer, this little popular thing that you get to a point in your life and you decide, now I have arrived at a point of clarity and a point of wisdom. Now I want to sit down and I want to write a letter to my younger self. It's a popular thing. I want to be able to go back and talk to my younger self and via a letter and tell my younger self what my now wiser self has learned that will have helped you along the way. Well, that's fine. But how about you in your wisdom take a child right now and tell that child what you would have written to your younger self? Because you do know that your younger self can't do nothing about it. You ain't young no more. Am I talking to anybody? But you have someone in your face that if you were to share your life and share your wisdom, maybe, just maybe, they would actually take the advice that your younger self should have taken. Am I talking to anybody? See, fathers, this is your very version of a do-over. Okay. You can actually improve the life of someone else today. Okay. This is a better version of you right now, right before you. It's a privilege to be a father. Can I get an amen right there? Yeah. As we look at the scripture that was read in your hearing, in just for a few moments, I want to highlight three reasons why it's a privilege to be a father. It's a privilege to be a father. Obviously, all of them are coming out of verse number 4. The first reason there's a privilege to be a father. Because father is a promotion. But Justin, father is a promotion. The verse says, as the Apostle Paul starts to, as he's writing this letter to the church at Ephesus, verse says, and ye fathers. Now, to really get the promotion out of the privilege of being a father, we have to go back a little ways. Now, let me just tell you something that I know you already know, Sister Faye. I know you know this, but I'm just going to tell you anyway. I'm going to take a chance. You guys do know that when the Bible was originally written, there weren't no chapters. When Paul wrote a letter to the church at Ephesus, he just wrote a letter. It's kind of like you deciding to write a letter. You ain't going to put no chapter 1 and chapter 2. And so someone got together and broke the letter up into chapters. So chapter 6 is simply a continuation of chapter 5. In chapter 5, starting at verse 22, I'm telling you it's a promotion. Watch this. The Bible talks about wives, submit yourselves to your own husband. The man has gotten a promotion in chapter 5, verse 22, because now he got a wife. He's a husband. He has been promoted now from single man to married man. The Bible says that she is to submit herself unto her own husband. Then they start telling the husband to start loving her like Christ loves the church. In other words, the husband, just like a pastor, is God's representative in the church. A father, or a husband, I'm sorry, is God's representative in the home. But at this point, as he is a God representative in the home, he looks to her like Christ.
Come on.
You ain't got to be loud on me on this one. Watch this. She is to see Christ in her husband. When she cannot see Christ for herself, she ought to actually see Christ actually in her husband. If she sees Christ in her husband, she will respect her husband as the church is supposed to respect Christ. Now we get down to chapter 6, because now we got a single man that has been promoted to a husband, but then chapter 6 starts off talking to the children. It says, children, obey your parents in the Lord. You don't get to be a child without a father.
Come on.
It says, children, obey your parents in the Lord. Then it says, honor thy father and thy mother.
Come on, God.
The Bible is telling us, watch this, it's telling us that I just promoted this man from single man to husband.
husband and gave him a wife. But along the way, because he is Christ-like in the home, he actually is designed to produce disciples in the home. And the best disciple in a home with a godly man is a child. So then, the next promotion, he moves from single man to husband to father. Let me hurry up and tell you, it's a privilege to be promoted to father. Why would I say that? Because even though it seems like we don't know these people, but there's a ton of people who cannot have babies. I already told you, we don't know the people. No, we know the folks that you breathe on when they're pregnant. Drinking that tea. But it's God himself that decided, I don't care how you came to be a father, it's God himself who decided to actually allow a seed to come through you to actually come out to be a baby in the earth realm. No baby is an accident. It may be an accident to you, but it's not an accident to God. Every child is precious to God. There is no such thing in the kingdom of God as an illegitimate child. There are some illegitimate parents, but there is no such thing as an illegitimate. Am I talking to the Lord? Your name might be but their name ain't promotion, because watch this. In chapter 5, the wife is told to respect her husband. But in chapter 6, the children are told to obey. With all of our imperfections, God has designed someone that it is his command that they obey our voices.
Yes, sir.
That's a promotion right there. Yes, when you ain't nobody on your job, you come home to a child and they got their arms up waiting for you to pick them up. And they're simply waiting for you to tell them something. It don't matter what you say. They are designed to obey, and not just obey, they are designed to honor you.
Come on, man.
They will brag about their little daddy. And he ain't worth a hill of beans. Oh, they be talking about my daddy. My daddy.
Come on, man.
That's my daddy.
Come on, where's my daddy?
Where's my daddy coming home? Look, they are designed to honor. That's a promotion. Because when everybody else is calling you everything but a child of God, they are calling. They don't care what mistakes you made. They don't care where you've been and who you're dealing with. They don't care about all your junk. The only thing they know is you are daddy. It's a privilege to be a father. Am I talking to anybody? Not only is it a promotion, it's a precaution. It's a precaution. The Bible says, and ye fathers, provoke not your children. It's a precaution. There is not a lot of positions that we are called by God to do where he gives us a warning and a caution before we actually do anything. I have made the mistake in the past by saying, as a father, there's no book that's written to tell us how to do it. I repent before you today because that was a lie.
Amen. Amen.
Yes, the Bible says, provoke not your children. You're already asking me, how do you provoke your children? It's a privilege to be a father because you get instructions on how not to provoke your children. Watch this. Don't provoke your children in not being there when you're supposed to be. Remember, you're Christ's representative in the home. You look like Christ to the wife, and you also look like Christ to the children. Christ won't ever let you down. So if you are supposed to be there physically present, then fathers, precaution, be there. Don't deal with your children based on lies. But daddy, you said you were going to come to my game.
Yes.
But daddy, you said you were going to come pick me up. But daddy, you said you're going to buy me a new pair of shoes. Do not promise a child something you know you ain't going to deliver. Don't deal with a child based on your bad relationship with the mama. It is not the child's fault that you and the mama don't get along. They had nothing to do with that. Fathers, precaution. Please be careful not to talk to your children negatively about their mama.
What you say? What
you say? Well, let me hurry up and give you some insight. That child is going to grow up, and he or she is going to remember you talked about my mama, and you said you love my mama. But now you're talking about my mama. You said you love me. Are you talking about me too? Because if you won't love my mama and you'll talk about my mama, it's just a matter of time before you won't talk about me. Because half of who I am is my mama. And every time you look at me, are you seeing the bad stuff about my mama? Are you talking about my mama to other people? Are you talking about my mama in my face? Man, you don't know who you're talking about. You will. If her name was so and so when you made the baby, her name don't begin with a B or a W now. And stop trying to get the children on your side. Took you to court for child support. I don't care what she said you didn't do. I don't care if she lied on you. Do not talk about them kids' mama in their face. Because what can a child help you do? And don't ever underestimate the loyalty of that child to their mama. Just a matter of yo.
Wow.
Don't provoke your children by always being angry. You mad at the world all the time. To the point that the children and everybody in the house trying to read you when you come in the door. I don't know if we can talk to him today. Like he already mad. You are the representative of Christ in the home. Can I hurry up and tell you that if you're the representative of Christ, Christ don't beat nobody up in the house. Christ don't give no black eyes. Christ don't cuss nobody out. Christ don't take nobody's money. Christ don't talk about nobody negatively. Christ ain't angry all the time. Christ don't have no gambling problem. Sometimes we are so messed up that we start spewing our negativity and spewing our shortcomings and spewing our mess on a child. Children were not designed to handle grown people mess. Go to work. Precaution.
Come on.
Go to work. Precaution. Go to work. Precaution. When you go to work, bring the money home. Don't stop by the gentleman's club. Don't stop by fire keeper. And don't stop by your other girls. It's a privilege to be a father. But if every time your family needs something, you ain't got nothing, but you done spent it before you got home, you are actually not an asset, you are a liability to the whole family. Is this making sense? Don't impose your negativity on your children. Provoke not your children to wrath.
Come on, Jack.
Point number three. And we out. 25. Let me see if I can get it in 5 minutes and get y'all out of here.
Come on.
Father, they so worshipful to myself. It's a privilege to be a father. Because fathers, that's a promotion.
Amen.
You've been promoted from single man, hopefully, to husband, to father. And while I'm there, let me just tell you, if you skip the little second promotion, the child still is looking to you to be Christ in the home.
Amen.
So, same rules apply. But there's a promotion, there's a precaution, then there's a purpose. It's a privilege to be a father because of the purpose. What is the purpose of a father? According to the scripture, it says, "And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord."
Amen.
Now let me walk that last phrase back so that we get the full meaning of this purpose. The last word in the verse, it says Lord.
Yes, sir.
Which means there's a presupposition that the father, who has been called a father at the beginning of the verse, by the time you get to the end of the verse, that father is in the Lord.
Amen.
Notice he didn't say in the casino. Notice it didn't say in the club. Notice it didn't say in the street. Notice it didn't say in another woman's house. Notice it didn't say in another woman's bed. Notice it didn't say any kind of thing but in the Lord. Listen. Don't try to send your children to church and you won't come to church. Because the verse, that phrase, it starts off now back at the beginning. It says, and bring them up.
Yes, sir.
Which means to grow them. And it's very difficult to grow something from a distance. Let me talk to Sister Vera Simpson. Me and her can talk right now. Because she got that plantation up there on that plantation up there. When you plant something, you have to be there to put the seed in the ground. And when you grow something, you have to be there to actually take the weeds from around it, to actually water it, to actually dig around it, and actually allow some time with you in the plant where you're watching it and seeing what needs to be done. If it was a running bean, you gotta go get a stick and stick it so it'll grow up. You can't do that from afar. It says, bring them up. So your physical presence has to be there. Lord have mercy. Then it says, in the nurture and admonition. Nurture, Brother Justin, means to train. It is difficult for you to train somebody and you ain't there. Train them on what God would have you to train them. How are you gonna teach them a scripture and you don't know no scriptures? Their biblical questions and you don't know no biblical answers? How are you going to teach them how to work and you won't go to work? How are you going to teach them how to manage their money and you spend every dime you get? How are you going to teach them how to save and you can't make it till tomorrow? How are you going to teach them how to retire and you don't know what the number 401k needs stand for? How are you going to teach them how to do business transactions? You ain't never been to the bank. How are you going to teach them how to do their homework and you ain't been to school since when? How are you going to teach them how to read and you don't read nothing?
Come on, man. Yes, sir.
The purpose is to train them. You train them best by allowing them to watch you do what you're supposed to do. It is still holy to get your rusty dusty up in the morning. Put your clothes on and go to work and let your children see you do it. It is still holy to actually pray with your family. It's still holy to bring them, not see them, bring them to church. Holy to get in ministry and then make them get in ministry.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
nurture. Nurture, train, admonition. It is to point out what the responsibilities and duties of the training is. We started this year the junior ushers.
Amen. Yeah.
Now I give you a great picture of a father. We have a father figure.
Yes.
And Brother Ronnie Sim. Here's what he did. He actually pulled the young people together.
Yes.
And early on, when they ministered, he was ministering with them. Why would you send a child to do something you ain't told him how to do it? And then get mad with them when they don't do it right. Talk about this generation. I remember a time when a generation ahead of us, the mamas would get together and they would have crook sewing parties. And these mamas would be on each corner and along the way. But every now and again, you look underneath that quilt and there's a child under there. Because the child is sitting there with the mama. Now the mama is talking to the rest of the grown folk, because back in the day, children couldn't talk. And you put them in the presence of grown folk. So you just sat there and you listen. You watch and you listen. And as mama is tapping her feet and she's pulling that needle in and out, she's actually showing that child, this is how you do it. She didn't actually tell the child to go make a quilt on their own. She had the child right there. And the next thing you know, that child will grow up. And even if they don't think they know what they're doing, next thing you know, they got a new little friend. And they're doing that thing. That quilt come together and it got all them patches. And it got all them pieces. And how they know how to do that? Because the purpose of the father and the purpose of the mother is to train the child. Are you talking to anybody? Before I close this out, let me point out something to you. The word nurture. It means train, but it's most commonly used with a mother. It says, and ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture. Most of us men ain't nurturing. You don't believe it? Let our son go out and fall and bump his knee or something. Yeah. Boy, get up, boy. You all right? Child can barely walk. No, you all right? Ain't no hurt. Be a man. Put your pants up, boy. Be a man. But the Bible says, fathers, nurture. The purpose of the father is to also work along with the mother. So that whatever the father don't have, the mother can come on in and seal the deal on that thing. See, every now and again when I was actually disciplining my children, my wife was not only my wife, she was their defense lawyer. She would come to their rescue every single time. Now she loved Jamila, but she especially came to us, did that one right there. She was his lawyer. And when I wanted to be hard on him, all she wanted to do was nurture this child. And it's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. My wife, I get as a father, allowed me to be nurturing and to admonish my children. He also gave me an example over 2,000 years ago. Over 2,000 years ago, he showed me what it meant to be a father. Because a father, just like a husband is supposed to love her, his wife, like Christ loved the church. Which means that a husband should love his wife to the point of dying for her. If he will die for his wife, that same father with a promotion will die for his children. Can I tell you what my father did? My father Jesus, he died for this little black boy right here. What Friday on the field called Calvary. He didn't just get a promotion that day and die for me. He took precautions. He allowed them to make sure that they put nails. There's a promotion. It comes with precaution. But it has a purpose. The purpose is to make sure that a father is reproducing disciples for the kingdom. Because he's not just training and not just pointing out responsibility to do this. It says, in the Lord. Our job as a father, yeah, we provide, get bills paid, keep lights on, all this stuff. That's good. But God is looking for more than that.
Yeah.
He's looking for someone that looks like his son to produce someone who looks like his son.
Amen.
That's the purpose. And it's a privilege. And fathers, when we get to heaven and we give an account on what type of father we were, let it be said, let it be known, we was the type of father that was pleasing to God. And we left a legacy, a generation behind us that is also headed in the same direction. So that is our purpose. If you're here today, you've heard a word that encouraged your heart. Yeah, we got a lot of mothers here. I do want you to know that in that particular verse, that complete set of scriptures, it started talking about the husband and wife, then it was the children. And that was a biblical assumption that by the time we got to chapter 6, that the husband and the wife was automatically together. So then everything that pertains to the father pertains to the mother. We ain't gonna go back and preach on Mother's Day, but you just latch on and you'll get a father's blessing also. You're here today, you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You know that it's that time. You know it's time to actually get another promotion, promotion of salvation. That's you. The Bible says you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. But say, you shall be saved. Are you here today? Are you here today? You're already saved. But you need a church home. You need a place where you can be taught or fed the word of God on a consistent, regular, high quality. Come. This is your time. Would you come? yourself on Messenger. Let us know how this word affected you, impacted you. Let us know if we can be a blessing to you. We believe, God, and we believe that it's a privilege to be a father. Clap your hands and give it praise for us. We ain't gonna hold you up. We're gonna go ahead and get you out of here. Once again, happy Father's Day to all the men who work here that I can your lives of the Father. Please pass on to them from this pastor and this church. Happy Father's Day. Bless them. May God keep them and remind them it's a privilege to be a father. You don't mind holding the hand of the person next to you. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for this privilege to be in your presence. We thank you for allowing us to see another Father's Day. And we love the fact that you are the ultimate Father. We thank you that we heard in the sermon that Father is a promotion. We heard that Father comes with precautions. We also heard that Father has a purpose, and the purpose is to train up the child, grow him up, and train him in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, so that every home with a Christ-like father is producing Christ-like children for the kingdom. We love you today, those of us who are fathers, who have been re-energized for our purpose. And if there's a father here who don't have children in their home, find some young person and be a father figure. Same rules apply. Lord, we thank you for this, your people. Continue to keep us in perfect peace with our minds stayed on you. We pray for traveling grace for those who are going to be traveling soon. We pray for all those on the sick and shut-in list, those who are in hospitals and nursing homes. We lift up Sister Johnny Craig. We lift up Sister Elizabeth Carter and all the others. We continue to pray for those families that are going through the treatment process. We love you that you're still on the throne and you're still able to keep our minds stayed on you. As we leave this place, but never your presence, we leave with your love, your peace, and your joy. We love you today. It is in Jesus' matchless name we do pray. And all of God's people together said, Amen. 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 Somebody tell them you love them. You are the Prince.